I am Dr. Jagdej Kaur Garewal, Assistant Professor, Department of Art History and Visual Arts, Punjab University, Chandigarh. In this module, the period following the end of the epoch of the great Mughals, Akbar, Jahangir and Shah Jahan, is discussed in detail. The state of painting and the decline of patronage of the art parallel to the decline in the fortunes of the Mughal dynasty are examined. In the light of this, the work being done that carries forward the earlier legacy of Mughal painting while also exhibiting the preferences of the later Mughal emperors and the socio-political changes that impact the art form from subject matter to style are studied in detail. When it comes to Mughal painting, the focus is essentially on Akbar, Jahangir and Shah Jahan and their interest in the arts. In the period that follows, the beginning with the reign of Aurangzeb, a dismal picture is painted of the state of painting. But as we examine the period, what emerges is how crucial this phase is in the larger narrative of Indian art. The post-Shah Jahan era indicates the experimentation in art that is to follow. In fact, it is a period significant for the alteration of Indian culture. From Aurangzeb to Bahadur Shah II, a period of more than a century and a half, there appear emperors who cultivate the art and artists who respond by creating masterpieces that, while drawing upon the past, look to the future. We shall start with painting during the time of Aurangzeb. The city of Shahjahanabad, established by Shah Jahan in 1648, was a bustling center of spiritual, cultural and political significance. His third son, Aurangzeb, who also defeated and executed Dara Shikoh, the eldest son and rightful heir, deposed Shah Jahan in 1658. Unfortunately, the transition of power to his least favorite son, who according to accounts is portrayed as a ruthless ruler with puritanical policies, led to the moral and artistic decline of the Mughal Empire. It is believed that the emperor was not unlike his father Shah Jahan in his early years of rule, but his attitudes hardened with time. Historians are of the view that his religious biases increased, damaging the harmony of the empire and affecting the practices of the Italia. Though recently, some scholars have presented a reassessment that the emperor was a pragmatic ruler, less orthodox, tyrannical and centralized than previously thought. In this context, the subjugation of history painting and disbanding of the imperial atelier under him are under reconsideration by art historians. Even as the emperor did not show empathy towards the arts, with music being banned and painting not eliciting much interest, yet artists continue to produce important miniatures and album leaves. In fact, in this context, let's briefly discuss some folios from a Khamsa of Nizami done for Aurangzeb when he was still a prince. Our first observation is that of the miniatures being graceful and intimate as opposed to being formal or imposing, as was the case with the productions for the Emperor Shah Jahan. The work becomes even more relevant to our discussion because art historian Linda York Leach is of the opinion that four scenes showing the hero Behram Gur portray him in the likeness of Aurangzeb. The historian further adds that it suggests that the prince was the patron of the manuscript and that the artist, in an attempt to flatter his patron, based the image of the hero on Aurangzeb. In fact, art historians point out that contrary to popular perception, the art of painting continued to be practiced, and even though the quality was in decline, the work being done does not seem to have lessened. Percy Brown highlights an interesting observation that even as Aurangzeb is pictured hunting, traveling, reading, governing, and commanding his army like his predecessors, in most paintings, he is depicted as aged. This begs the question that does this indicate that the painter's art was given royal assent by him later in life, or is it just an indication of a not very consistent patronage of the art? Names of a few artists working during his reign too have come down to us, which include Anoop Chhatr, Chhajmal, Ilyas, Bahadur, Ilyas Khan, Lachman Singh, Muhammad Afzal, and Shamdas. Whereas some of the themes that continue to be dealt by these artists are portraiture, battle scenes, military campaigns, hunting scenes, etc. But the production of illustrated manuscripts by the Italia virtually ceased. Particularly, the art of portraiture practiced under Aurangzeb is a carry forward of the traditions practiced under his father with minor alterations. The love for rendering the finer details, rich costumes, capturing physical and facial likeness persists, but we observe a loss of insight into the character of the subject. A genre seemingly favored by the emperor, though, was battle scenes, campaigns, and sieges, especially those of the Deccan. Many such paintings have been identified, and a typical example is that of Aurangzeb at the siege of Bijapur. In this, we see the golden nimbus figure of the emperor dominating the picture plane, with two figures in the foreground in postures that mark their surrender to him. Previous Mughal emperors too had ensured the immortalization of their military feats in painting, but that is where the commonality ends. The decline in the art is articulated by Percy Brown as, "Gone is that feeling of sincerity, so characteristic of the earlier work, and in its place, an artificial rendering which is neither a portrait nor a picture." The conquest of the Deccan by the 1680s and the presence of Mughal artists in that region resulted in cross influences between the two schools of painting. This led to what is referred to as a Mughal Deccani style, as is visible in a portrait of Aurangzeb by Khemanand that depicts the emperor with Azam Shah, his second son. Even as principles of Mughal art are seen in the construct of the portrait, the influence of Deccani painting is revealed in the gold shading on the throne and the costumes. As the imperial patronage was drying up, leading to a reduction in the imperial attire, a number of artists had started to work in the bazaar, which also led to the nobles and courtiers commissioning individual pictures from them in this period. Due to their interest in the pursuit of pleasure over that of governance and conquest, the subject matter in such commissions gravitates towards scenes of love and romance. It is here for the first time that we see focus on this genre, a subject matter that went on to enjoy popularity for a long time. Now we look at court painting under Bahadur Shah I, Jahandar Shah, and Farukh Siyar. The 18th century marks the period of decline of the Mughals and especially their political fortunes following the death of Aurangzeb in 1707. Meanwhile, region after region continued to break away. In the south, there was a remarkable Hindu revival as the armies of the Maratha Confederacy defeated successive Mughal armies. In Hyderabad, Gujarat, Bengal, and Awadh, regional Mughal emperors took power for themselves and founded dynasties. Although the Mughals saw them as minor overlords, they were in reality independent. During the years between Aurangzeb's death and coronation of Muhammad Shah, Delhi was a hotbed of political struggle, having seen seven figures ascend the throne, with only Bahadur Shah I and Farukh Siyar ruling for an extended period of time. The imperial atelier at Delhi continued to produce works after Aurangzeb during the reigns of Bahadur Shah I, Jahandar Shah, and Farukh Siyar. During this period, two court styles existed. The prolific of the two continued the artistic style practiced during the reign of Aurangzeb, with static darbar scenes having figures in colorful court costumes. the example of a work on these lines, made under the patronage of Bahadur Shah I, is a painting by Bhavani Das entitled Shah Jahan's Four Sons and Two Grandsons. This tradition of painting continued at least in the initial years of the reign of Bahadur Shah I and Farrukh Siyar. The other style emerged when, with time, artists gradually appear to ignore the stylistic achievements that had been in vogue during the zenith of the Mughal painting tradition. There appears a shift from the formal compositions preferred by Aurangzeb or his predecessor, and artists became increasingly conscious of spatial conventions and perspective. One approach was that the space was usually confined to a shallow foreground with an empty sky or wall at the back. Eventually, a distinguishable palette developed, along with a decorative and highly refined approach to figural representation. Thus, the second, or the new painting style that evolved, had a different tone and treatment. Farrukh Siyar, with members of his court on a hunt, is a good case in point. The evident alterations in execution include reducing the size of the secondary figures in comparison to the page size and placing them in the middle ground as opposed to the baseline previously. Even though the figures have volume, the recession of space is ambiguous. There is restriction in the use of colors, pale greens, white and brown. In fact, McInerney associates this new style with the court of Muhammad Shah and is of the view that transition from the old style to this characteristic Chitarman style took years due to experimentation. Now we should look at court painting under Muhammad Shah. The reign of Muhammad Shah, who went by the epithet Rangila, initiated a revival of Mughal painting which had been in decline. Most importantly, he reunified the imperial Italia that had reduced considerably in the preceding decades, leading to a new surge in imperial painting. Archer states, under Muhammad Shah, luxury returned to the imperial court, painting acquired a greater opulence. The term Muhammad Shah revival, commonly used by historians too, refers to the Renaissance in art rather than politics. Shah rarely went to war, and Delhi seems to have acted as his administrative and recreational microcosm, undergoing cultural and intellectual resurgence. In fact, Dalrymple and Sharma underline this as a period of cultural revival by observing that during his reign, Delhi saw the coming together of at least 22 scholars and mystics and a host of Urdu poets, musicians, dancers, and painters, which without an iota of doubt would have helped breathe new life into the court culture and practices. It is believed that Muhammad Shah had a very personal relationship with the painters, and this synergy resulted in the emergence of distinctive works that reflect the emperor's exuberance and lifestyle at court. An early Nim Kalam portrait of the ruler with partial coloration by Kalyan Das, alias Chitarman II, is a good case in point. Malini Roy notes that the work highlights the emperor's fine features, such as his athletic physiognomy, arched eyebrows, neat facial hair, and distinguished nose with its bump. She further adds that there is a degree of intimacy in the portrait, illustrated by the emperor's informal jama and bare minimum of jewelry, echoing the relationship of the ruler with his attire. The attire flourished under the Khanzad or palace-born artists, such as the above-mentioned artist Kalyan Das and the artist Hunar II. Some other important artists include Nidhamal, Fakirullah Khan, Govardhan II, Bhupal Singh, and Mir Kalan Khan. their works bring to life most vivid portraits and montages of the 18th century, picturing courtesans, backgrounds of elegant gardens, and cultural vivacity at the Mughal court. Amongst the artists, Chitarman II played an instrumental role in defining the style under Muhammad Shah. Artists Nidhaman and Hunar II matched his talent. Out of these, Nidhaman was more original in his conception, whereas Hunar II didn't show much independence, as his working style was greatly influenced by Chitarman II. Some of Hunar's early works are even mistaken for Chitarman's. Both Nidhamal and Hunar had an adaptable nature, and thus they spent the second and longer parts of their careers in Awadh and Bengal, where their styles transformed in those courts. Govardhan II specialized in harem scenes and influenced the works of Fakirullah and Mir Kalan Khan. The Mughal atelier under Muhammad Shah excelled at creating unique portraits of the emperor, and at the same time, encouragement seems to have been given to artists to consider other genres such as literary themes, ragamalas, and views of life inside the zanana. Now we'll briefly look at style, technique, and themes. Some of the easily perceptible changes in the works of this period include doubling of the picture plane and folio size, along with the use of the horizontal format and sumptuous background settings. The works employ vibrant tones to depict atmospheric conditions or elaborate gardens and create vivid contrast against the detailed white pavilions or interior views. Overall, the designs are simple, having clear details and fresh colors. Compositions have an architectonic structure with sharp and crisp contours or shapes achieved via delineation by line. Little tonal modeling is observed, with preference for subtle gradations of white and grey with accents of brilliant colors. Paint is applied in thin layers and burnished with enamel-like opacity. It is slightly unfortunate that no illustrated biographical accounts of Muhammad Shah's reign exist, but it is through the portrait paintings commissioned by him that his personality and reign are reconstructed by historians. McNerney has mapped a chronology for the works under Muhammad Shah's reign on the basis of the changing physical features in his portrait, such as facial hair, moustache style, and the growing waistline. Poignant portrait studies, commemorative achievements, and formal darbar scenes distinguish the ministers who remained within his inner circle, reflecting the equations at court. Despite the alterations that came about, the artists also continued to rely on conventional Mughal compositional types such as terrace scenes, equestrian portraits, and jharoka window frames, or emperors and princes enthroned. A work not far from the vocabulary and tastes of the bygone rulers is Muhammad Shah Riding to Battle, attributed to Chitarman II. The clean-shaven look with long handlebar moustache helped historians identify it as a portrait from about 1720-25. It depicts the emperor astride a horse in a jaunty mood. The background of this work could not be more different from similar flower-scattered foregrounds during the reigns of Bahadur Shah I and Farrukh Siyar. Here, the skies are awash with colors and fantastically shaped, coiled or curling clouds. Nonetheless, the hallmark of Chitarman's style, that is, attention to structural detail, is clearly evident in the portrait. But McInerney notes that the work lacks psychological insight, which was to deepen his later portraits. Another work, Muhammad Shah with Female Dancers and Consorts, is attributed to the artist Govardhan II. The influence of Chitarman and his geometric composition is seen in this work. Overall, the figures in the composition lack unity as they are of unequal sizes and occupy separate planes. Notable in the work is the modulation of space that is now confined to a shallow foreground with an empty sky at the back. In the next example too, Hunar adheres to the strict Mughal convention in an accession portrait, where he employs a double composition on the facing pages of an album depicting Muhammad Shah and his grandfather Bahadur Shah I. Both the rulers are enthroned and surrounded with traditional symbols of royalty, including a golden chhatri and attendants holding flywheels. Malini Roy compares the work to a 17th century masterpiece from artist Bichitr in the Minto album, showing Akbar handing the crown to Shah Jahan in the presence of Jahangir. After looking at these examples, it becomes clear that the atelier by this time had not agreed on a common approach to painting. It is only when the emperor himself takes full control of the atelier post 1725 that we witness a consolidation of a hard-edged and spatially reductive style with an air of unique formalism typically associated with Muhammad Shah and his patronage. Thus, after 1725, appear works that typify the preferences and practices under Muhammad Shah. This leads one beyond pure portraits to darbar scenes executed by the atelier. It is here that we witness a deviation from the typical 17th century darbar scenes that depict Shah Jahan seated on a terrace or in an audience hall receiving countless courtiers. Conversely, the artist now started to focus on a small number of identifiable ministers with the emperor, usually shown being carried on a palanquin surrounded by his entourage. The background of these works are surprisingly empty when compared to 17th century darbar scenes. The works overall depict concrete activities and settings with a camera's eye approach to render them. This precise physical depiction and introspective quality are reminiscent of Jahangiri court painting, whereas the quality of subjectivity in these works make them contemporaneous to the times. To put the subjectivity in perspective, in the words of Terence McInerney, the subject is not the event itself, but the meaning it must have had in the emperor's mind. The choice and arrangement of the formal elements convey a powerful undercurrent of subjective emotion. Two examples of this genre are a work entitled Muhammad Shah with Four Courtiers by the artist Chitarman. Noteworthy here is the specifically detailed architectural space. McInerney interestingly points towards the arrangement followed by the artist while composing the figures in the foreground as they resonate the symmetry and strength of the columns and walls in the background. He suggests this setting as an echo of how sound and able ministers under the ruler served as pillars of strength to the governance. Another example is a work entitled Muhammad Shah Viewing a Garden from a Palanquin, which is one of the greatest garden paintings depicting the emperor in a state of escaping the realities, enjoying the vision of paradise on earth. There is an air of suspended action and perfect dreamlike calmness. The artist brilliantly flattens a three-dimensional world, but its spatial logic is still clear in two dimensions as objects move higher onto the picture plane as they move away from the lower margin. The artist also produced numerous portraits of key ministers and notable figures of the court from around the same time. The Nim Kalam convention was employed to draw detailed bust-length or shoulder-length portraits of many individuals. They appeared either individually or in conversation with the emperor or conferring with contemporaries. Particularly, Khan Dauran, appointed as the Mir Bakshi, whose name is inscribed in many darbar paintings and portraits, enjoyed the attention of the artists. His finest portrait has been attributed to Kalyan Das, who pictures the minister in his private quarters watching a musical performance. In this terrace setting, Khan Dauran sits listening to a group of female singers and musicians, with almost three-quarters of the picture space given over to architecture. Its white color, in contrast with the other colors, such as orange, green, gold, etc., imparts to the work a jewel-like brilliance. The sky is almost active, awash with the orange-gold hues of the setting sun and the deep grays of rain-laden clouds. Other themes popular during this period include hunting scenes, as seen in two prominent works of a later date by the artist Hunar II. Muhammad Shah proceeding to the hunt and Muhammad Shah travelling with attendants. Both are grand compositions, one having an all-embracing vista thronged by figures, whereas the other has an uncanny emptiness. The works lack the psychological subtlety and detailed backgrounds of Chitarman II, but retain his whitewashed palette. Around 1739, Delhi was attacked and plundered by Nader Shah, which led to the loss of the most talked about Peacock's throne and the Kohinoor diamond, and in all probability a substantial number of Mughal illustrations and manuscripts. This came as a major blow to Mughal power and cultural wealth. Post the invasion, the artistic quality of the Mughal attire was often compromised and declined as the ability of the emperor to oversee the imperial attire diminished. The paucity of dated painting during these tumultuous times makes it difficult to establish the state of the attire post Nader Shah's invasion. The invasion and its repercussions for the royal house and the city impacted the availability of imperial patronage for the artists. In all probability, to appeal to a wider patronage outside the imperial courts, there is a shift visible to more symbolic themes by the artists, such as Baramasa and Ragamalas, that appeal to both Hindu and Muslim patrons. Of the various illustrated manuscripts in this period, only one is of imperial standards, Karnama-e-Ishq, composed by a Hindu poet, Ram Anand Ram Mukhlis. The completion date of the volume is 1739. The first scene from the manuscript depicts the vizier Itimad-ud-Dawla Qamaruddin Khan received by the emperor. It is stated in this volume that it was a gift to Muhammad Shah by the said vizier. The manuscript otherwise narrates the romance of Prince Gauhar and Princess Malika-e-Zamani. Accompanying the Persian text in the manuscript are 36 illustrations by the artist Govardhan II. The succinct and refined style of the artist is clearly evident in a folio from this manuscript. Malini Roy discusses and draws contrasts in artistic practices during the decline by taking up examples of later works of a celebrated artist such as Govardhan II. Commenting on one of his Baramasa paintings, she says that in these works, such as for the month of Aghan and Asin, the artist skillfully renders the faces of the women, but the setting or the environs seem to be hurriedly painted. Without any reservation, it can be concluded that the contribution of Muhammad Shah to Mughal painting in particular and the art of Indian painting at large is enormous. The work done during his reign had an impact on the schools of painting in Rajasthan, Jodhpur, Jaipur, Bikaner and Kishangarh. In fact, his celebrated artist Chitarman II had a profound influence on painting at Kishangarh, where painters such as Bhavani Das and Nihal Chand introduced a romanticized version of the former style that was followed as a model for the school. And the Punjab hills too were greatly receptive to the variants of Muhammad Shah's court style, especially seen in the works by Nain Sukh. But the irony remains that Muhammad Shah's style of painting was out of vogue in Delhi by the time court painting began under Akbar Shah II and Bahadur Shah II. The invasion of 1739 and the aftermath as a consequence leaves little evidence that Muhammad Shah and his successors Ahmad Shah and Alamgir II were able to uphold the revived painting tradition of the 1720s and 1730s. After the death of Muhammad Shah in 1748, Delhi suffered a string of invasions as control of the city swung from one party to another, reducing it to ruin. As the power of Mughals gradually declined, that of the British steadily increased as they filled the vacuum slowly by transferring themselves from a mercantile organization into a colonial organization. By 1764, the British East India Company had won a major victory against the Mughal Emperor Shah Alam II and his allied forces, the regional governors of Bengal and Awadh. In 1803, Emperor Shah Alam II officially opened up the doors of the Red Fort of Shah Jahanabad for the company's commander-in-chief, General Gerard Lake. This was in turn followed by the idea of opening a permanent British residency in Delhi. Now we briefly look at court painting under Shah Alam and Akbar Shah II. Delhi court patronage of artists and literati resumed during the last quarter of the 18th century under Shah Alam II and continued into the reign of the last two Mughal emperors, Akbar Shah II and Bahadur Shah II. The usual Darbar scenes too continued under him. Another work, a Shahnama manuscript, is an interesting case in point. It is its execution during such strained time that makes it an interesting study. Leach is of the view that Shah Alam II attempted to evoke the past glory of his house by patronizing such works, or that it might have been produced to impress the visitors at the court. A total of 28 miniatures illustrate the epic in this manuscript. The style and hand seem consistent. This period offered an unprecedented opportunity for artists to broaden and reinvent their approach to painting by also producing work for the British East India Company officials in Delhi. In the court paintings of Akbar Shah II, we see a palpable effort to strategically maintain the precedence of imperial prestige over the British. Akbar Shah's court assemblies were attended by a host of officials from the courts from adjoining regions such as Jaipur and Alwar. As a result, the broad networks of artistic patronage reached as far as the satellite courts and towns of Delhi, such as Sardana, Hansi, Firozpur, Jhajjar. And Alwar. Traditionally, art historians have conceived of company school painting as something quite separate from the art of the later Mughal period. Dalrymple and Sharma are of the view that, and quoting from them, such distinctions are actually meaningless, certainly in Delhi at this period, as the same artists were working in similar styles for very different patrons. The leading artists of the day, notably Ghulam Murtaza Khan, Ghulam Ali Khan and Mazhar Ali Khan, were not only supported by the Mughal court in Delhi, but also by the city's European residents and courts around Delhi, providing many extraordinary points of interaction, quotes close. An interesting interaction between Prince Alam Shah II and French officers begins in 1758. It increased manifold in 1759 during his exile in Awadh, and when he became the emperor. Mildred Archer, in a book on company school paintings, acknowledges the French company paintings predate the paintings produced by Indian artists for East India Company. Two important names emerge here in this context: Colonel Jean-Baptiste Gentil and Antoine-Louis Poulier, who had great interest in Indian manuscripts, music, numismatics and Indian culture at large. They collected Mughal miniatures and manuscript paintings, including a full copy of the Four Vedas done in Jaipur for Poulier. The paintings that are part of the Montini collection show the Red Fort and the Jami Masjid of Delhi, as well as the Taj Mahal. There is also a large collection of paintings of the monuments of Delhi, commissioned by Gentil and executed by an artist from Faizabad. European painting had acted as an integral stimulus since Akbari times, but more so in the time of later Mughal painting, as artists adopted and adapted features in portrait and landscape painting. evident clearly by the mid-18th century. Features such as naturalistic poses and groupings of figures, fascination with form and movement being just a few elements that enriched their art. One of the most prominent artists of the time was Ghulam Ali Khan. The context under which he gained prominence and produced work was that of the dual patronage of the company and the Mughal court, which in turn reflects the artistic culture of those times. The artist's career spans four decades. To him are attributed key portraits of Mughal emperors, Akbar Shah II and Bahadur Shah II, and he also worked as a topographical painter, especially for William Fraser, and he also worked as a topographical painter, especially for William Fraser and James Skinner, and was in demand amongst company circles. He also executed key paintings like the Regional Court of Jhanjar and the notable commission of a copy of Gulistan for the Rajput court of Raja Banni Singh of Alwar. The artistic trajectory of Ghulam Ali Khan through his innovative works not only seeks to transcend established conventions and stylistic forms, but also incorporates new ones and amalgamates the two. A great deal of work attributed to him falls in the category of topographical drawings, which were in vogue during the early 19th century in Delhi and were in all probability commissioned in sets around 1820 to 24. Parallel to the works mentioned above, he seems to have developed his skills in figural portraits and genre scenes by working for William Fraser, now compiled as the Fraser album that contains genre portraits of cavalrymen, retainers and officials. The artist captures likeness with great competency, and his work stands out for the use of transparent washes of watercolors, elongated figures and stippling to emphasize the trace of the brush. Most importantly, we notice the attention given to the rendering of hair and facial features, characteristic of a miniaturist. Other than the obvious visual and ethnographic records of the inhabitants of Delhi, these works give us an insight into the company politics and how the British and Indians were intertwined socially and culturally. The following portraits of Mirza Salim and his father Akbar Shah II, commissioned by Lord Amherst, show how the artist departed from the formal structure of Mughal court painting. The seated prince and the emperor with their hookahs convey polite courtesy rather than regal power. Nimbus around Akbar Shah II's head shows royal presence. Yuthika Sharma points out that in the portrait there is a humanizing air reflected in the difficulty with which the girth of the figures encased in silken fur overcoats fits into the chairs. Now we come to painting under the last Mughal emperor, Bahadur Shah II. The end and the beginning. The last Mughal emperor, Bahadur Shah II, also known by his pen name Zafar, was one of the most talented, tolerable and likable in his dynasty. He was a skilled calligrapher, a writer on Sufism, a patron of painters, creator of gardens and also an amateur architect. The highlights of Zafar's patronage are the decorative arts and painting. Under him, Delhi saw a final revival of Mughal court painting, but within new conditions that spawned a fresh visual culture in the city. Mughal scenes were no longer limited to the confines of the palace walls, as simultaneous dissemination of the work occurred in the marketplace. Mughal portraits, court scenes, and popular Delhi subjects were replicated on ivory sheets and mounted on furniture, frames, jewelry, and even lapel pins. An example of Ghulam Ali's work for the court before and during the reign of Bahadur Shah Zafar gives some insight into the changes in the art. In an accession portrait of Bahadur Shah Zafar done in 1837-38, Yutika Sharma notes how the portrait is a choreographed dynastic portrait of Zafar in the presence of his sons. The historian notes that the work is actually painted in a non-traditional makeshift location against a pierced marble screen featuring the scales of justice, which has its entrance and the waterway streams below concealed with carpets. The work is overall a dignified portrait study, emphasizing the emperor's authority and his entitlement for choosing a successor in this accession portrait. Ghulam Ali's later work at the court of Bahadur Shah II during the last decades of the latter's reign dealt primarily with illustrating dynastic histories, particularly stressing on the rulers of Delhi. He collaborated with another artist, Babar Ali Khan, to bring this work entitled Portraits of Exalted Emperors to life. Yutika Sharma here observes that the work deviates from a painterly court style in its quick washes of color and quick brushwork. This commission in itself seems to have taken place in the context of the growing realization of shift of power and resultant regal insecurities. Thus, in totality, Ghulam Ali played a pivotal role in increasing the dialogue of pictorial vocabulary between the court and company circles through his commissions. More importantly, the fluid diversity and innovation that seeps into his own works because of the socio-political environment sets him apart from many artists who later tread the path followed by him as a painter. The most complete pictorial and literary record of the last days of Mughal Delhi can be seen in the album entitled Reminiscences of Imperial Delhi, commissioned by Sir Thomas Metcalfe from 1844-45. The album, attributed to Mazhar Ali Khan, the nephew of Ghulam Ali Khan, contains a series of images of the monuments, ruins, palaces and shrines of the city. In conclusion, by the 1750s and 60s, with the gradual decline of the Mughal court and royal patronage, and in the face of the ascendancy of the British, the imperial attire too was in decline, with the number of artists reducing over time. Some artists stayed on in Delhi, finding other types of employment or worked at the bazaar level, whereas prominent painters and poets migrated from the Mughal court to the provinces in search of patronage. A few of the principal artists of Muhammad Shah's court later appear at the provincial courts in Bengal and Awadh. Munir II accompanied the Mughal heir Shah Alam II to Murshidabad during the years 1758-59, though more artists, including Fakirullah Khan and Nidhamal, settled at Faizabad and Lucknow. This migration resulted in the artistic style of Delhi finding expression in the provincial court, making the intermediate phase of Mughal painting even more complex for historians to understand and analyze. By 1780, many Mughal style paintings betray and celebrate the nostalgia for the old Mughal empire, as in these works we come across musicians, mullahs and dressed courtiers. This tendency was to provide the basis for an industry in the early 19th century, recreating these environs and the nostalgia for a bygone era for visitors to Delhi, many of them British.